What is your very first memory of UC Irvine?
Well, we were coming home from Arizona at Christmas time. The chancellor decided it was, well, he wasn't chancellor yet, but he knew, he had made up his mind that he would accept the invitation. And so he thought maybe he would take us up to show us where it was to be. We came about late afternoon from Tucson. It was foggy, it was cold, it was the first of the year. And we stood up there and looked out over the valley, foggy. We didn't know what it was going to be because it was this dark sort of valley ahead of us. Well, my older son said, "Doesn't matter to me, Dad, if you're going to come here, I'm going to be in Davis," because he was going to Davis next fall. And Elizabeth looked at up and then broke into tears. "But there's nothing here." And we said, "There will be." His father said, "There will be." And our youngest son didn't care a bit. He was out running after the dog that had gotten out of the car. So that is a memory that I have of us sitting up. And I looked at Dan, and I could tell by the look in his face that he had made up the decision to accept the leadership here at Irvine.
Erwin Rockefeller. Again, I'm with the University of California, Irvine. First of all, I want to say a gracious thanks to Mrs. Jean Aldrich for inviting us to be here with you tonight. I think you're going to learn some things that maybe you didn't know before. We'll have some questions and answers and things of that. So we really want to make this a fun evening for you, a midsummer, late summer night's conversation about this place just right across the street called the University of California, Irvine. Please give another warm welcome to Elizabeth Liz Aldrich Toomey.
Thank you. Thank you.
I'm delighted to be here tonight. And Daniel G. Aldrich III.
Thank you as well. It's glad to be here again.
Children of Mrs. Aldrich and Chancellor Dan. We have a sibling here who's not with us tonight, isn't that right? Why don't
Stuart?
We tell the rest of the story? Family.
The youngest brother.
The youngest brother.
Stuart Hamilton Aldrich.
Oh, okay.
Named after my mother's maiden name. He was the young one. I'm the old one, she's the bright one, and he was the young one.
I actually kept them both in place.
That's exactly
and
correct.
And continue to keep them in place.
Absolutely correct. Absolutely correct.
So we have a little presentation for you tonight. We have the PowerPoint. But I want to start us off by looking at just a 4-minute video clip. Who here remembers Chet Huntley? Remember who Chet Huntley was? NBC Nightly News. I used to watch Walter Cronkite, but I still occasionally would switch over and watch NBC News and Chet Huntley. Well, many, many years ago, why don't you tell us when that was?
Well, he was here in 1964, and this production that you're about ready to see, The Birth of a Campus, was the program that Chet Huntley came out to the Irvine campus, the ranch, to film. It was a very interesting time in history, and UC Irvine was really one of the first research universities that was going to be addressing the needs and interests of the 21st century. And that, I think, was the nugget that was so attractive to the Chet Huntley team.
Well, and the other thing I have to say on that front is that there were, I mean, in many ways, this was all a part of what was viewed as the golden era of California. And that isn't to say that we're not going to have future golden eras, but everything was happening in California. There was an explosion and a whole reflection of what was education and how education was going to be providing for all of the people of California. And so California was being looked at in a different way. There was the California Water Project and how we were going to transform and address the great numbers of people that were in California and the development of that. And there was an interesting governor who was a creator, and that was Edmund G. Pat Brown. And he was also somebody who had a great vision for what California was to become. And so all of that investment that was going on by the state in terms of building a place where people could come to and thrive was something that they wanted to capture. And so this came as a pass
exactly.
of that.
It was also a time in which the University of California as a system was looking down the telescope and could see a population of future students that the university at that time was not ready to welcome. Between Berkeley, UCLA, San Diego had come on board, Davis was there, Riverside had started an undergraduate program, but they saw the need for this huge population that we are part of, or were part of. And so they were looking at, we need more campuses, and here we are.
So let's take a little look at this clip.
For one whose education and professional career had been up until this assignment spent entirely in behalf of agriculture, there's little wonder at the thrill I experience each day as I come out and view this great agricultural landscape and see what is taking place here. We began the building of Irvine in 1962, just 100 years from the time that Abraham Lincoln signed into being the Morrill Act, which set in motion the great land-grant system of higher education in this country. A nation was concerned about the education of a rural people 100 years ago, but today we in California are concerned about the education of thousands of young people and hope in the building of this campus to provide a quality educational opportunity for those who come now that is equivalent to that which our state colleges and universities have provided in the past. We are not concerned about the education of a rural people, but the educational needs of all the people. And from the classrooms and laboratories of this campus, which will admit its first students in a few days, we expect to flow knowledge that will be of interest to those who one day will take their place in the jobs and career opportunities of this state and the nation, and to meet the needs of people as they confront the problems that face them each day. Those of us who have the opportunity, the freedom to pursue ideas on this campus, feel a real sense of commitment that the ideas that we pursue shall be shared with students on the campus and off the campus. We expect, therefore, in the coming years to see Irvine take its place among the great general campuses of the University of California, and that the students who go forth from here shall have received an education of quality and of character and of diversity that will enable them to respond appropriately wherever they may find themselves. While the Irvine campus of the university is being developed as a general campus, like its sister campuses, with programs in biological sciences, physical sciences, social sciences, humanities, and fine arts, and in professional schools of engineering, and one day medicine, and law, and architecture, we're concerned that programs developed here complement those on sister campuses of the university, thereby offering for the young people of California a greater array of educational opportunity than if we simply attempted to duplicate what was present on other campuses. Since Irvine sits in the middle of the most rapidly growing urban area in the country, with all the problems attendant to the spread of people across the landscape, we're hopeful that out of our various disciplines will flow information that will assist people in solving the many problems that confront them. We recognize that man has many problems confronting him: pollution of the landscape, pollution of the atmosphere, pollution of water. Hopefully, out of the resourcefulness, ingenuity, and creativity of faculty gathered here, ideas will be developed which will enable him to solve his problems, to make this place a better place in which to work and to live and to play. We expect to do this through programs of teaching and research on the campus, with particular interest in moving the information from the campus to the community through extension service and service programs. I'm frequently asked how we expect the Irvine campus to be different from any other campus of the University of California, or for that matter, from any other campus in this country. I suppose our principal point of difference lies in the fact that we start every program here at Irvine new, be it in the administration of business affairs, or student affairs, or in academic affairs. For example, in our Division of Biological Sciences, we shall not set up departments of botany and zoology, physiology, and microbiology, but rather we will organize in an interdisciplinary basis, beginning with the simplest unit of biological material, the cell, moving from the cell to the organismic level, and from the organismic to the population level, where discrete entities of biology, be they animal or plant, are considered in an environment. And we'll also be concerned about psychobiology or the biochemistry and biophysics of behavior. We also have opportunity to encourage youngsters to move into programs outside of their major field of interest and take courses and programs in areas not immediately allied. Thus, the chemist should be encouraged to venture into the courses in Shakespeare, or those in English to pursue programs in physics. Students are overly concerned about grades today, many of them, and therefore are reluctant to venture where they do not think they can get an A or B grade. Irvine, as a consequence, is arranging a pass-fail program for students, encouraging them to go into fields outside of their particular field of interest. As we look over the campus, we see that these buildings are large ones, of a scale to accommodate one day some 27,000 or more students. We must constantly work at this business of making things human in scale, of showing our concern about the individual. To do this, we've arranged our residence halls not in monolithic structures of 500 to 1,000 students, but rather as cottages of 50 students each, in which groups of 8 students, 4 such groups of 8, or 6 such groups of 8 in each cottage, will have an opportunity to come to know one well, to assume responsibilities for one another, and in essence, express the concern and interest that each individual has in his fellow individuals, a very important consideration in this time. The first students and faculty at Irvine have a fantastic opportunity as well as a great responsibility. For whatever they shall do now shall set the patterns, the character, the standard of this campus, which one day will be the traditions of Irvine. We have done our best to recruit from throughout this country as well as throughout the world best faculty that we can possibly obtain, knowing full well the quality of the faculty to set the academic standards of this campus. Good minds attract good minds, and if we are to provide the best educational opportunity for qualified young people, we begin with a first-rate faculty. Students who come to this campus qualify on the same basis as every other campus of the University of California, and we are sure that programs established here, the laboratories, the classrooms, the kind of faculty, the library, will provide them an exciting learning opportunity. We don't expect them to take away from here recipes for success, nor do we expect them to be encyclopedias of knowledge, for knowledge changes at such a rapid rate. We would only hope that within these resources, we would have assisted them in learning how to learn. But we're not alone concerned with curricular life. Extracurricular life at Irvine is an equally important part of the development of young people coming here. The charter students will have the opportunity to plan the programs involved in student government, in student newspaper, various student organizations, the kind of living facilities that shall be developed here, all making for what we hope will be an exciting, an interesting, and profitable first year at Irvine. For what they shall do here sets the pattern for what will come in the future.
I should say that what's an amazing thing about this, in the days of today when you have many sorts of outtakes and redos, he did that without any notes, walking and talking the entire time. So in terms of a gentleman that understood the vision that he'd been given bring to pass through many other people, and the University of California, Irvine isn't the creation of just one individual. The great talents of our father was the capacity to excite others to then take their own visions and make it the great institution that it has become. So it's a collection of incredible people who have come together to make an institution that, quite frankly, in the context of the University of California, like no other campus, has become truly the epitome of what he thought it would be, and that is one of the greatest research universities in the 21st century, ranked in the top 50 in the world.
Mm-hmm.
And that in and of itself is an incredible statement about two things. One, the vision of an action of many people, but then also the collective investment, not only of the people of California, but the many other benefactors who have helped make the institution what it is today, and will even be greater in the days to come.
What I find particularly interesting in my father's vision, the articulation of a vision that, as my brother indicated, was one that was his and the team that he brought around him, is how much of that has been realized and how much is yet to be realized. And this will be something exciting for all of us in this room, as well as all of the residents of Orange County and beyond Orange County, because we are reaching far beyond Orange County now, that this is going to be very exciting. This is going to be a campus that is constantly evolving. And that was very much a part of the vision and has remained the spirit of the campus through other leaders.
You know, what I find so interesting about that clip is two things, well, three things actually. Yes, he did the whole thing off the top of his head, one take, which in Hollywood terms is remarkable, phenomenal. So articulate, setting a vision that lives today.
Mm-hmm.
In fact,
yeah.
I work in campus now, and every single day we share that vision and live that vision every single day from whence it first started. Second thing I love is it sounds like to me the wind whistling in the hill.
Oh, yes.
Absolutely.
Yes.
Third thing, where was all the grass and the trees? I like to say that there was Orange County before campus.
Absolutely.
Right, absolutely.
And there was an Orange County before campus, and what was that like?
It was rolling ranch land, and looking at the pictures that we have here starting on our left, that is the chief of the Chumash. And there are times when I, in my position in community and government relations, used to think, at certain times, was it a blessing that we had here, or was it not a blessing, as those ups and downs of campus life would
present
themselves.
And I have to ask you, Liz, this setup of a question, I've never asked her this question before. What's your first memory of stepping into a place called Irvine, which was to be
called
the university?
I wept.
She cried. 1961 December, we used to go to Tucson, Arizona every Christmas, and we would come back and we would come. We were all born in Riverside, California, and this one December, Dad said, I want to take a side trip before we go back to Berkeley, and so we wended our way down the Santa Ana Canyon, two-lane highway, came down through MacArthur on MacArthur Boulevard, two-lane highway, went on up on the Newport Coast Hills, opened the cattle gate, went out. It was gray. It was cool. The only things that you saw were cactus, rocks. You looked across the Santa Ana Valley. Nothing except two things, the lighter and air facilities out there. That's all that was there. You looked across, and as you looked across further, you then saw some fields of peppers and tomatoes, and then also citrus, but that was it. And Dad got us out of the car, and Mom was there, and I got out. And he said, "Well, what do you think about coming here?" I said, "Dad, you can do whatever you want to do. I'm going to Davis in the fall." Liz,
I'm a sophomore in high school.
She said, "Why would we leave Berkeley?" In tears. My brother was playing on the rocks, okay? And my mother said, "Danny, if this is where you want to come, we're coming."
She did that every 4.5 years until we settled here in Irvine. It was always. But, you know, I would pick it up and I would say, okay, it's my responsibility to put a smile on my face and get on with it. So I would, but I did. So I went.
Yes, you went. And you. And so imagine coming from Berkeley to the Irvine Ranch.
I mean, and this is the amazing thing. You look out across this place now, talk about a transformation of the landscape. It's simply incredible. I mean, nothing was here. And I mean, we used to come down from Riverside when we lived in Riverside. We'd go down to San Clemente. I learned to body surf down in San Clemente. We'd go down there in the summertime. And I think it was 1952, and that was when Queen Elizabeth was
coronated.
Mm-hmm. And we saw that coronation in a theater down in San Clemente, California. But also at that time, there was a World Scout Jamboree, okay, Boy Scout Jamboree, on the hills just over here where the Hyatt is, and back going back up on there. And that was just, there was nothing, folks. No. I mean, zero. And you saw the Boy Scout Jamboree, and that's why Jamboree Road is Jamboree Road, because of the basic fact that the Irvine Ranch hosted the World's Boy Scout Jamboree.
So what were the Native Americans doing in this picture here, in this photograph here? Well, were they living on the site?
No. They had been invited to come onto the campus and see where the campus was going to begin to be developed, and also really to bless the land. The Chumash Indian tribe had lived throughout this area, so we were probably on perhaps sacred ground.
And so we know who the gentleman on the far right is, but who's the gentleman in the middle slide?
That is Ellie Cox. He is no longer living, but Ellie actually was the first employee of the University of California, Irvine. He was brought here to the area to begin to develop the financial
physical planning for the campus.
So he was the first.
He was a retired Marine colonel and came here and was hired by the Regents to begin the process of collaboration with the Irvine Company, and then beginning to sort of aggregate the material side of things to enable the buildings to begin to emerge.
In fact, the picture, the background for Ellie is the old Irvine Ranch house that was out at the end of Myford Road.
Right. That's Joan Irvine Smith, and she was a transformative agent, because she actually took on something which was the Irvine Company in large measure. Many people were dubious about wanting to have put together the ranch, and seeing emerge a transformation of one of the most significant agricultural enterprises in California, that was the Irvine Company, and helped begin to transform what was then the ranch lands into not only a place where the university could come to pass, but where an amazing city would eventually evolve as well.
What are we looking at?
We are looking at William Pereira, who was the architect that was hired by the Irvine Company, correct me if I'm wrong.
Actually, the Regents first.
The Regents, okay.
And then it was the Irvine Company. But I mean, William Pereira was Pereira Luckman, a distinguished Los Angeles-based architectural firm. He then split off on his own. But I would have to say that this site, Orange County, et cetera, was because of Bill Pereira. The reality of life is that he was he had a vision as well. He had a master plan vision that emerged from discussions with Clark Kerr, who was the president of the University of California, as well as my dad. But the reality, he had the political acumen and the brilliance in terms of putting together the plans, et cetera, that sold the Regents.
But this is exciting, to look at because it really hasn't changed much. When you go and you look at the evolving master plan for the campus, there was always this sense of we have it's built on a circle, concentric circles that are moving around what is known as Aldridge Park today, and that's what's in the middle. And then in those circles, there are also quads, and those we can talk about because those are the quads of the various disciplines of the campus.
The amazing thing also is that it was unique. Most universities elsewhere, there were really sort of rigid either boxes or rectangles, etc. And you will see that this has a much more free-flowing sort of situation. And the other unique aspect of the innovative aspect was that the bringing into the campus through the spokes what were known as inclusion areas, mm-hmm. and so that there would be drawing in the university which evolved the University Research Park and other things which were to break down the barriers between that which was the community and that which was was the emerging university.
So all these visionary people at the very beginning came together and they shared mm-hmm. this vision.
Right.
And again, we still see that vision alive mm-hmm. today.
Absolutely. Right.
So now we move into some of the renderings of campus, early renderings of campus. Does any of this look familiar to you?
It does.
Absolutely.
Here is again, of course, the circle in, you know, Aldridge Park there. And
the big thing is that thing over on the far right never... Right.
This.
Never materialized, will never materialize, okay? And that was, Pereira thought he wanted to have, like at Berkeley, there's the campanile, and that there needed to be something that was visually unifying the campus in some sense of the way. My dad, being one of agriculture, felt that the park was a place in which one could come together and it would be much more reflective. And so the interesting thing is, no structures were built in the park, okay? Mm. The park was the park, and this was an opportunity to meld together a whole series of horticultural and other sorts of flora that then made the park what it is, a contemplative area and a place where people could come and interact one with another rather than being, pardon the expression, brutalized by some other sort of man-made structure.
Well, we may get that tower in later years here. You know, we have another 50 years to go.
Oh,
so we'll see what happens.
There's a lot of people that say that they're not going to get towers.
Who is the gentleman in the middle? Ray Watson.
Ray yes. Watson. And of course, if you walk from here across through University Center to the campus, to the Barclay Theater, you will cross the Ray Watson Bridge. Ray Watson was a young man that was brought down from the Berkeley area. He was at UC Berkeley, and he was brought down here to actually be the master planner for the city of Irvine. And he and Dad lived together, in fact, for X number of months out at the old Irvine Ranch house. And they had an enormous respect for one another. They shared the vision of what was going to take place, not only on the campus, but what was going to be happening in the city of Irvine. And so Ray was the master planner of the city that you all reside in. And Ray passed on here last year.
Yes. Mm.
And but he was a visionary of another sort, and that was an urban community.
And quite frankly, of all of the, and this was a period of time when they were thinking about the building of many new communities.
Mm-hmm.
Adjacent to Washington and elsewhere. The most successful master plan community created was by this gentleman right here, in collaboration with a number of other people. And that then has played, he played a number of significant roles in terms of a lot of that which is the education that occurs in the School of Social Ecology mm-hmm. and certain mm-hmm. programs at UCI. And his departure from us was a huge loss to our area.
So many wonderful visionaries. So we move into construction. This is the campus?
That's
the
campus.
This is the campus site many years ago. What year do you think this might be?
I'd have been in 63, 64. Mm-hmm. I mean, they're still moving dirt.
All right.
I apologize.
Soil.
Okay.
Our father was a soil scientist. Soils are much more... engaged because there are all sorts of little creatures in the soil. Dirt is... No.
We break ground, we start having construction on the campus here. Shed Huntley and your dad there. Look at the station wagon and look at the wonderful Bear Hill.
Isn't it amazing?
Isn't it
the landscape?
Amazing to see where we were then? So we now start construction.
We do.
The very first building start to go up, the cafeteria, and the natural sciences and engineering. There's the beginning of the library, of course. Here are some other sites. Do any of these look familiar to you?
The one up on the top left is over in the humanities area. That is the thing that stands out in an iconic way is the arch that
right.
you see there.
Right.
This lower one on the left-hand side, I think we've debated over that
that's still
one. That's still humanities?
That's still humanities.
And then
okay.
the library is yeah. the one over
on the other one. In fact, that was where the administrative offices were located on the top floor there after they moved over from their little...
Butler Building on the North Campus, which is
right.
still there.
Here we have some young individuals right here. Do you know who these gentlemen are here?
We have Sam McCulloch on the left.
That's James March, who was the first dean of social sciences on the far right.
And can you tell us what this little trailer over here on the side is?
That was used. That's Irvine Center.
That's the Irvine Center.
That's Irvine Center.
University
that was.
Center.
It was a collection of things and
trailers.
Trailers, and one of them got burnt down at an appropriate point in time, or I shouldn't say an appropriate point in time, but it got burnt down.
It was
down.
That point in history.
It was a point in history. Yes, absolutely.
What happened in June of 1964? Who was this special visitor? What do you remember about? Did someone come to campus? Who what? And why would they come here?
Yes, the President of the United States, and that was Lyndon Baines Johnson. And the story, actually, Daniel and I will share this story. Orange County, at that time, was the home for the John Birch Society. And this was a very conservative area. And Mr. Johnson, President Johnson, needed to establish a presence here in this area because he knew that this was going to be a growing area. This was an important area for him to have some kind of a presence in.
This was an election year?
This was
Absolutely.
An election year, and there had been some difficulties, and so there was outreach, obviously, done to individuals here in Orange County to see if President Johnson would, or would the university be open to having Mr. Johnson come and dedicate the campus.
How did that go over?
Well, like a lead balloon. I mean, the interesting, the reality of life is that my dad and the people here, I mean, it's wonderful at one level to have a President of the United States come, but it also is a great interruption to their, they had a primary mission, and that primary mission was to be open by October 4th, 1965. And you have to change everything to then be responsive to the President of the United States in terms of that dedication ceremony. And so, it was a huge, huge time sink in terms of getting prepared for the welcoming of President Johnson because you can imagine that only 10 months earlier there had been an assassination.
Mm-hmm.
And here you were coming to a place which may not be welcoming of a president. So they had to make sure that they had incredible security that was set up, and the Marines actually surrounded the site from El Toro. He had to be then helicoptered into the site to be special, and there had to be a vetting of everybody that was in attendance. So it was a huge time sink that interrupted the development and of the campus. So it was at one sense wonderful, but a horrendous challenge to those who were trying to get a university open.
In fact, my father, we were living in Corona del Mar at the time, and my father drove out on MacArthur and came across on what is today University Drive, but at that time, it was not much more than a hard dirt road that went along in front of the marsh. And as he drove out very, very early, he saw a man walking along that dirt road, and that man was not the president, but it was the greeter from Laguna Beach. And he wanted to be here to be a part of this historical day of the President of the United States coming to dedicate the University of California, Irvine. And so my father stopped the car and invited him to come on in, and they drove out to the site. the site where the dedication took place, where 20,000 people from Orange County gathered on that day, that June day, is at the corner of Campus Drive and University, right there, where today Mesa Court is located. And so, as my brother indicated, the security was unbelievable. We knew that there were going to be three helicopters that were going to be coming over from El Toro Marine Base. At that time, we did not know, and so all three landed, and then we all watched